so much for saying to you the TV folks are taking a very 30-second minute break, and if we keep going back and forth, we'll use up the 30 seconds very quickly. 50% of the electricity generated in the United States is from coal, underscoring the role that it plays. The future looks like it will be coal-oriented if you take seriously that we are now building 30 coal-powered plants that are under construction now that will burn 70 million tons of coal per year. You've already noted that in 1948, we produced the same amount of coal we produced in 2008, and then we had 125,000 workers, and this year we had 20,000. We're making the transition, I think, to talk about surface mining. And surface mining comprised 40% of the coal production in 2008. Bobby's point is that it is simply not environmentally compatible at all to do surface mining, and there's no case that can be made for that. You might have a different view.
Well, first thing, I think that this debate is similar to the environmental movement. You know, the playing by the rules is important if you're going to get the right answer. But so we need an adequate amount of time to respond to I don't know how many different issues. If there are truly more people employed in the windmill than there are in the coal business, then they've got a real problem because they produce about 1% of electricity and we produce about 50%. So there's a real issue there. Solar energy, by the way, it works well in the daytime, gets cold at night. It's a real problem. A lot of those solar components, by the way, and those panels are made outside the country. Windmills are primarily going to be made in India and China. Mr. Kennedy is on record as having said that recently, that we realize that the construction of windmill parts and so forth will be made overseas. I don't really know how you respond to an ongoing speech about these issues. I really feel badly about that. But to the question of how we're going to be prosperous when we use coal, well, you better realize that that's what made us prosperous to begin with. It's what is making the Chinese prosperous. They were at 700 million tons of coal in 1980. Today they're at 3 billion. If you're going to think you're going to lower the mercury content in the ocean by reducing mercury in the United States, only 1%, not 60 or 70% of the mercury that's landing in the United States is coming off of U.S. coal-powered power plants. About 60% of it is coming from other sources. A great percentage of it is coming off of Asian coal production. We're in a situation where we compete in the world, and we're trying to if you will, have totally open markets. It's going to be very difficult for this country to compete with the labor standards it has, with the environmental standards it has, and so forth, let alone with the energy costs that would come with windmills and solar panels. We've already lost, as people in this room know, Century Aluminum. We've lost nearly every aluminum plant. We lose our chemical plants because we try to use natural gas to make electricity, which is an entirely inappropriate use for natural gas because it should be used in bakeries and industrial processes, and the cost should be kept low. If we follow many of the policies that the environmentalists want us to follow, we're going to cause our homes to be as dependent on foreign energy as we've caused our cars to be. You can't build a refinery in this country. When Mr. Kennedy talks about not being able to eat the fish, the Chinese and the Indians burn 4 billion tons of coal and eat their fish uncooked out of the China Sea. If the mercury was a real problem, they'd all be dead. They wouldn't be living until they're 79 years old. You have to think about things in a practical way rather than believing what you hear in the media or what you can read. You can read it and hear anything that you want to hear. But can this country and this state and the world make a prosperous society out of coal? Yes. If you look around the world, the places that are prosperous have electricity, and most of that low-cost electricity is made from fossil fuels. It is true that natural gas can play a big role. It's true that nuclear can play a big role. It's true that windmills and solar panels can play a big role. But the idea that you're going to stop all surface mining in West Virginia over water like this, many of you might think this is drinking water. This is discharged water that violates the EPA standard while you're trying to compete with Chinese slave labor and people that don't even have to get a permit is atrocious. It's just not going to happen. You have to make choices in life. And these surface mines recover a lot of reserves and a lot of energy that could not otherwise be recovered. They don't have any meaningful pollution, although the media would have you believe that. And they, people aren't sleeping with their clothes on because they're afraid that an impoundment's going to break. The impoundment in the school that made so much press coverage in West Virginia were there when I was in grade school. We reclaimed, we Massey Energy, the two most dangerous impoundments in West Virginia, which were at Mock Coal and Starrett at Willing Pit in Logan County. The one at Willing Pit was the subject of a WVU study. Again, you're criticizing people in the coal industry who have gone to school, become engineers and geologists, and become professional people who are employing your friends and your neighbors in the best way they know how and creating a great economy for this state and for this area, and also providing low-cost electricity to this country that allows it to be competitive in a marketplace that it otherwise could not be competitive in. And it's easy to spout out rhetoric, but the truth of the matter is that if were it not for coal, we wouldn't have the freedom to sit up here and discuss it.
Don, I've seen the studies that have projected that by 2020 there would be, you'll get, you've had chances and you'll get them. I've seen studies that have said that by 2020 that there'll be a 40 to 50% decline in coal production in central Appalachia. Do you think that it is time for the economic health of West Virginia to begin to diversify the economy? And if we were to diversify it, is alternative energy a part of that?
It's been time to diversify since 1890. It's always good to have a diverse economy. It's not coal that's keeping us from having a diverse economy, except it lulls the politicians to sleep, and they think because they have all this revenue off of coal that they don't have to worry about the future. But the truth of the matter is that the reason businesses aren't in West Virginia is because they get sue the daylights out of them, and because they tax them to death, and because they don't feel comfortable being in a state that has no punitive damage limitations. If coal is driving businesses out of the state, why is the chemical belt here in Charleston shutting down? It's shutting down because we drove natural gas prices to be so volatile that they run from $4 up to $12, and the chemical industry can't survive. So where do they go? They go overseas because we have open trade borders and they produce the coal and other, or the chemicals in other countries without any labor requirements and with very few environmental requirements, and therefore you lose the jobs that you had here in Charleston.
If the forecasts are accurate, that we're going to have a 30, 40, 50% increase in the demands for energy in the United States and around the world, can alternative energies handle that, or do we have to find ways to make coal work?
I want to answer that. Let me just reply to a couple of things that Don said. One is the statistics I got about, that I talked about from, about the wind energy come from the Bureau of Labor Statistics. There's 85,000 people in 2008 employed in the wind industry. There's 81,000 the same year employed as miners. The jobs in the wind industry are very high paying, but more money goes to the workers. In your industry, for example, in your company, you actually take home more money some years than all your shareholders combined. So what the mining industry does, it makes a few people rich by making everybody else poor, whereas the wind industry distributes wealth and distributes the benefits of that industry more evenly. If you want to know what happened in Japan from eating all that mercury, Google Minamata disease, and you'll see something that will make your hair rise on end. It's one of the most horrific episodes in history. Yes, the answer is yes. I want to also say, reply to what you said about China. China is very dependent on coal, and it recognizes now that coal is the principal drag. Its reliance, its deadly addiction to coal, is the principal drag on capitalism and economic growth in its country. And it is now, and it recognizes also that the green energy economy is the future. China has committed this year to spend $7 trillion over the next 5 years developing its wind and solar energy, more than it's spending on its military. It sees this as a new arms race. We have been leading the world in wind deployment for the past 10 years. We're leading also, we're one of the leaders in solar deployment. We are building solar plants all over this country, and they're all being put out of business because of the investment that's being put in China. China understands. China is going to increase its solar deployment between now and 2020 by 20,000%. We plan to increase ours by 37%. They understand, and this, if we don't switch to renewables right now, and if this state doesn't think about how to start switching. We're going to be buying energy, we're going to be buying green technology from the Chinese for the next 100 years, the same way that we've been buying oil from the Saudis for the last 100. We need to get out ahead of this curve and start investing in these things and start thinking ahead and demanding our politicians build the infrastructure within our states and start subsidizing infrastructure to compete with the huge subsidies that we give to the carbon incumbents, to coal and oil.